Come, let's pray. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam. Blessed are you, Lord God, King of the universe. Blessed is your holy name. Father, we just come before you this Shabbat morning, Lord, to give you thanks and praise. Ruah Elohim, you're with us, you're in us, you're around us. You have empowered us, my God. And Father God, we just come before you, Lord, that you may expound your word in our spirits. Lord, that we may understand the deeper things of God. To know, Father, that Emmanuel, you are with us all the time, not some of the time. You're always with us. And we thank you, for you are the Moreh, the teacher. You are the light of the world. And we just pray that we will be blessed once again, because Father, we have come to seek your word. And we pray, Lord, that we will be blessed in Yeshua HaMashiach's name. Amen. Today's topic is about a Greek word called sozo. Sozo means salvation. Now, we have lots of terminologies that we use where we approach the world and we ask these questions: are you saved? Are you being saved? Can you be saved? These can actually have a lot of misunderstandings if you really don't get into the root of what this word is all about. So when we look at the English word saved, you really need to get into the Greek word, which is what was spoken, sozo. Now, sozo really means not just saved, but that you are taken care of by somebody else. Don't worry, I'll look after you. It's a done deal. We might say it in current terminology, it's a done deal. We are okay. You will be okay. It's an assurance, sozo. But when you say saved, you know, you're dying, yes. But in the context, it is God who's using the word. It is Yeshua who's using the word sozo. Rav Shaul, or Paul, is quoting what the Ruah Elohim is telling him. For example, you are sozo by charis. He's using the Greek word sozo, saved, and he's using the other word charis, which is where you get the word charismatic from. But charis means grace. You understand? Charis, C-H-A-R-I-S, charis. Charis is the Greek word for grace. Now, for example, when Rav Shaul writes his epistles to the different churches, remember, he was a Benjaminite, he was a Pharisee, he was an Orthodox Jew, but he uses a Greek word to open all his letters. He says, charis, shalom. Shalom is Hebrew. Grace and peace. Why? Because you cannot have shalom if you don't have his charis, his grace. So grace and peace. So let's look at what the scriptures say, because otherwise what happens is, if you go to the CPM, Ceylon Pentecostal Mission, which is an absolute cult, if you want to get hammered, go to the Pentecostal Mission. Don't go to Maradan at 12 o'clock in the night. Go there. If you don't wear white, right, if you don't stay celibate, if you don't do this, if you don't do that, you're not going to heaven, you're not even saved. You understand? It's a group or an assembly that condemns everybody. So they live in absolute bondage. Right? If you go to some other church, they'll tell you can do whatever you want. Right? And you're saved. So there are absolute extremes. If you go to the Roman Catholic Church, if you don't pray to Mary, then Jesus' death on the cross has been annulled, right? You have to do what the Pope tells you to do. So that's another debacle that you have to deal with. So we are being bombarded by different theologies of man. And that's why I always say, when I teach Acts 17:11, search the scriptures daily, just like the Bereans. Be like the Bereans. Search the scriptures daily. If you search the scriptures daily, You don't have to say, this pastor said this, this rabbi said this, this priest said this. You don't need that. The scriptures will speak out, because the word of God, the Logos, is transported by the Ruah Elohim, the Holy Spirit, into us. So that's why in Ephesians chapter 2, Rav Shaul says, you are washed by the word daily. But to be washed by the word daily, you must open the Bible daily. That's the next thing. So let's look at scripture. Are you being taught right? The biggest problem with most Christians is that they are, I would say 95% of the churches are teaching you something that's errant. It's errant. It's tragic, but it's errant. Because 95% of those pastors or priests or whoever have not studied the Hebrew and the Greek. So they have gone to a Bible college, which is speaking something in their own language, in their own cultural context. And as a result of that, they are now comparing it to culture as opposed to the Word of God. In short, what most people tell you is, yes, Yeshua's death on the cross was a miracle. A miracle, the greatest miracle is the salvation of the cross. But you need to do something else. You know, Yeshua died on the cross. Yeah, we accept that. Absolutely no problem. But you have to come to church on Sunday. Firstly, they got the day wrong. Secondly, they got the place wrong. What is church? Church is a Hebrew word called kahilia. Right? Kahilia means a gathering of people. The equivalent word in Greek is synagoge, synagogue, right? And from there you get that Greek word ekklesia, which means called out ones. So if you are called out, you can't be in a building, no? You're not called out to the world to be in a building. So the first group that was called out was Israel, called out of Egypt to go into the wilderness for 3 days and worship God. That's how this whole word kahilia came. The people God called out. Right? So the primary problem with most churches is that they have really never understood what sozo is. That's the big problem. The second thing is 95% of the churches are so dependent on people's money, and I'm saying this very, very slowly. Churches are dependent on people's money. That's the biggest sin that a pastor, a group of elders, or even the believers who support that church can get into. David writes in the Psalms, I look to the hills, where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord. If you are going to be dependent on people, you are dependent on a spirit called mammon. And people with money are people who like to control. You understand? If you take any charismatic church, any evangelical church, you will find that their leadership are all businessmen, CEOs of companies, directors, whatever. Those guys might be just coming to know Jesus, but suddenly, because the pastor who was riding a tricycle has got a bicycle, then a motorcycle, now suddenly he's got a Mercedes Benz. He is not going to let go of that guy. Why? Now he's in a Mercedes Benz. You understand? So suddenly the dummy who didn't know anything about Christ is now elder. Right? And then he walks around like the Michelin man. Right? He's all puffed up. He knows nothing, but he is buying himself the front row. So you expect the church to go right? No. You understand? Maybe he's not saved. Maybe the guy is still trying to find out who Christ is. You understand? You see, you can't build your own tower of Baba El. Baba El in the Hebrew, actually comes from the Mesopotamian language, right? Means gate of gods. You can't buy your gate and go to heaven. It is only by the blood. It's only by the blood. I am the way, the truth and the life. No man cometh unto the Father except through me. It's either through Yeshua's way, and Yeshua's way is through his word. No other way. So the first thing we have to look at is, are you being taught right? In Joel, now this is the Tanakh. This is the Tanakh. This has nothing to do with the church, please. The churches keep quoting this. Right? The churches keep quoting this. Even Kepha or Peter quoted this. Right? But he was a Jew talking to Jewish priests. So he was okay. But we can't use these terms. But I'm just trying to tell you, these are used by the church today. Joel 3:32. And it shall come to pass that whoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be delivered from the mouth, for in the mouth of Zion and in Jerusalem shall be deliverance, as the Lord had said, and in the remnant whom the Lord shall call. This is to do with Israel. They're nothing to do with you and me. It's very clear, no? He's calling you to Mount Zion. This is a messianic promise. This has nothing to do with current times. This is to do with the tribulation and the coming of the Messiah to Mount Zion. Nothing to do with the church. But I hear pastors quoting this. How on earth is the church going to Mount Zion? But they teach it. And they say it very boldly. It's very clear. And it shall come to pass that whoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be delivered, for in Mount Zion. Where is Mount Zion? You can't go to Mount Zion. So how are you going there? In your spirit? No. This is a prophecy of the prophet Joel to the Jewish people about the remnant, which Paul talks about in Romans 11, which is futuristic. Are we learning something here in the first passage itself? It had nothing to do with the church. Matthew 10:22. And it shall be hated of all men for my sake, and ye shall be hated of all men for my sake, but he that endureth to the end shall be sozo, saved. Now we take the end, right, as the last day of tribulation. Again, errant teaching. He is not talking about the Greek word eon, I-O-N, eon. He's talking about the Greek word telos, right? Telos means, if you're playing a football match, right, you are on this side, and the whole purpose of the game is to put the ball into the net on the other side. If you have worked your way through the defenses of the enemy or the opposition, and you come and all you see is a goalpost, a net, and a goalkeeper, you're in telos. You are in the right place to score the goal. You understand? So when you take the word end, he's saying the end of the road to where I'm taking you, or where you should be. We are on a walk. In this walk, there is a place where we should end up. We should end up. And telos, right, is that place. It's called the goal zone. We are being given a goal, right, of where we are supposed to walk to in our spirit. And that end place is telos. It's not eon. Now, we, according to a lot of pastors, they are preaching this, not understanding the Greek. And they are saying, see, here, the word of God says that we will be there, that we are supposed to be there till the end. No! He's using the Greek word telos. He has given each group an end, a place that we are destined to. Paul says in the book of Romans, we were predestined, preordained to a particular telos, to a particular place. The church, the born-again church, has a telos that the Jewish people can never understand. Because where we are ending up is not where they are ending up. We are going up in the rapture, whereas the Jews who have rejected Christ, the world that has rejected Christ, will go through the tribulation. So how can we all come to the same end? We can't. We have been given a goal zone, a place where God has foreordained us to end up in. And that's what he's saying. He says, men shall hate you, right? Because you follow the Messiah. But he that endureth till he reaches the goal. Now it's easier, isn't it? He that endures, waits on God, works with God, works through the Ruah Elohim, works through the Holy Spirit, till he reaches his end. What end? The goal that God has set you. You understand? Not the end of the world. Matthew 19:25. When his disciples heard it, they were exceedingly amazed, saying, "So then who can be saved, Lord?" Now, hello. These are Jews who know the Torah, who know the Tanakh. They are seeing the miracles of Yeshua, right? They're not people of this world. But they could not understand sozo. He's saying, "Listen, Lord, we have followed you. We have given up everything, right? And we are totally mixed up in our heads. According to you, who can be saved?" So if they can be misguided or complexed in their thought process, 2000 years on, how do you expect us to understand it like this? It's not by might, it's not by power, it's by my Ruah, says the Lord. Only the Holy Spirit has been given that exousia, that authority from the Father to teach it to us. And the problem is, the world has so many different churches that God has never planted. Do you get it? There are so many places that are saying, "I'm a pastor, I'm a church," and you go in there and there's more activity in a morgue than in a church. It's dead. I can walk into a place, and I know this place is dead. Because they are not appointed from above. They have studied the Bible like studying a book of history. You understand? They've got a piece of paper because they're intelligent. You see, you can easily gain knowledge. You can't gain wisdom. A huge difference. A huge difference. A lot of people walking around with a lot of knowledge, but there's no wisdom, right? So here, even the disciples were a bit complexed about who can be saved. And Matthew 24:13 says, "But he that endureth unto the telos, the same shall be saved." He's telling them, "Don't worry, guys. I have given you a goal." And do you know what that goal was? That out of those 11 that survived, plus they appointed one other person in the book of Acts, chapter 1, that out of those 12, only one would have a natural death. All the others, the telos that God had given each individual, was to be martyred. How's that? Not a very nice statement, right? If you know the telos that God has appointed for each one of us. Do you understand? But he's saying, each one of you has an end goal, which I have foreordained for you. Endure. He's not saying get there. Because then he contradicts Philippians 1:6, which says, "He who began the good work in you will perfect you." He's saying you endure. Hang on. I'll take you there. You see, I used to be a lifeguard. And I used to have to swim out to sea and pull those who were drowning. That's exactly what Yeshua did with Kepha, with Peter. And I used to just catch hold of the guy who was drowning, and I'm telling you, it's not a pretty sight, because their arms and legs, they'll scratch at you, they'll hit you, because they're drowning. And the first thing we were taught to do is to hold the person and try to talk to them and say, "Calm down, I'm in control. Sozo, don't worry, I'm in control." Right? Don't worry. And what you do first is hold the guy out of the water for as long as possible till he can breathe. And when you are in a situation, it is up to a man of God. Now listen, when you say man of God, that doesn't make me the man of God and Bhushan not the man of God, or uncle or Rifai. It means somebody who is in contact with God, a man of God, a man who walks saying, "I know where my help comes from." To hold that person and say, Can you breathe the Holy Spirit? Can you inhale what God has sent you? The beautiful, the glorious, the ever-loving Ruach Elohim, the Holy Spirit. Breathe Him into you and the life of God will come into you. That's all it does. You hold somebody and tell him, listen, you may be drowning, I'm not, and I'm not going to allow you to drown. But what I have, I give you, Yeshua HaNazareth, Jesus of Nazareth, the Holy Spirit. Breathe, and then that guy says, I was taking in salt water or river water, but now this air that I'm breathing in, it's so good. And then you start talking to him, and you start using the strength that God has given you to bring the guy back to the shore. And that's the Christian walk. Our job is not to stay in church and sing hallelujah. Our job is to go into the world, right, and pull those who are drowning. What are they drowning? They're drowning from the crap they believe that they call religion. They're drowning in their misery. There are people who are walking up mountains. There are people who are walking around a box called the Kaaba. There are people going into temples. There are people who are slashing themselves with swords and knives. There are Hindus who are hanging themselves on hooks like pieces of meat because they are trying to get to God. And Jesus Christ says, don't worry. I have torn the curtain. I have rent the curtain from top to bottom. And I have come through to you, that those who believe in me shall have everlasting life. Amen. But he that shall endure unto the end, the telos, the same shall be saved. Mark 16:16. He that believeth and is baptized shall be sozo, but he that believeth not shall be damned. So what's the catch here? The catch is belief. Belief. Right? It's all is based on one word, belief. If you believe that God can save you from whatever situation you're drowning, sozo is going to start taking place in you. It's like that. Luke 8:12. Those by the wayside are they that hear, then cometh the devil and take away the word out of their hearts, lest they should believe and be saved. What is he saying here? That the one thing that can impact you, that can change the way you think, is the word of God. And that is the situation with Roman Catholics. They are nice people. They are nice people. Actually, some of the Roman Catholics I know are much nicer than the people in the charismatic churches. I'm serious. You want to meet the nasties? Go walk into a charismatic church. They'll hit you, they'll shame you, they'll talk about you, they'll disgrace you. They'll kick you and say, I love you, brother. Because hypocrites under the sun. The thing that transforms one person from being the soul person to be the spirit person is the word of God. Faith cometh by hearing, and by the hearing of the word of God. And actually, if you look at it in Greek, he first says logos and then rhema. Faith comes by the logos, the word, and out of that comes the rhema, the revealed word. Now in English it says faith cometh by hearing and by hearing the word of God. Wrong translation. Hearing and hearing the word, the logos and the rhema. The rhema is this, what the Holy Spirit reveals to you. Right? So here it's saying that the devil, right, Hilael, the Hebrew word Hilael, the light bearer who fell, Ha-Satan, he is the one who will come and take the word out of you. Right? How does he do it? By attacking your head. Or a television program. I have to watch this match. Oh my gosh, without this match, my life will come to an end. Those guys who are playing don't even know that you're watching them. Whereas if you read the word of God, you know God loves me. Luke 13:24. Strive to enter in at the straight gate, for many shall say unto you, I will seek to enter and shall not be able to. Don't create your own gates. Don't create your own gates, because those gates are very wide. you know, I have to do my marketing today. I have to do this today. I have to do that. I have to listen to my husband. I have to listen to my children. I have to listen to everybody. Then I'll come to the Bible study. That's the wide gate. You're so full of excuses that your name is also excuse. Right? But the person who is seeking God, that gate is very narrow. That gate is so narrow that very few people find it. I'm serious. I can look at people and know they're on the broad gate. They're on the broad gate. They're on the broad gate. Yeshua says you will look at a tree and you will know the tree by its fruit. You can look at a person, listen to what that person is saying and know he ain't found it yet. He ain't found it yet. No chance. You can be standing in a church and you can be as dumb and as dead as the corpse in a coffin. Just because you stand in a church don't mean you found it, because you're not seeking God. You can be in a church for all the wrong reasons. That's that wide gate. You can be standing in a church. You can be standing and listening to the best preacher in the world and you can be as dead as a doornail. As dead as a doornail. Because you are not there to seek Him. Right? He says strive to enter at that straight gate. Strive. Make an effort. Once you start making the effort, you'll get there. As I tell you, if you look at my life, I have strived and I'm still striving. Because I know that where I am is because of the Lord Himself. You heard the prophecy earlier today. That man has never met me. He has never seen me. Right? But the moment he laid his hand on me, the Holy Spirit revealed what was revealed 10 years before through another pastor in the mouths of two or three witnesses. So I know the path I'm going on because I have strived to enter through that small gate. But once you enter through the small gate, it's an open field. It's an open field. You see, are we learning something here today? Luke 18:26, and they that heard it said, who can be saved? And he said, the things which are impossible with men are possible with God. Why is he saying this? Because even the disciples who was walking around with him for 3.5 years, they were thinking in their minds and not in their spirits. That's why he tells them after his resurrection, wait in Jerusalem for 10 more days. Wait until the Ruah Elohim comes. Then you will be transformed. Transformation can only come from God. He's saying you might look at a strategy which is very human and you will say, this is not possible. But he said, with God, all things are possible. So what is he telling you? That you have to actually take your situation. It may be finding a job. It may be finding a house. It may be finding a partner. Whatever. You take that and you hand it over to God. How do you do it? In faith. Luke 18:28. Then Kepha, Peter, said, lo, we have left all and followed thee. See, from their point of view, they were looking for something in the physical. They were looking for a physical remuneration. But what God was going to take them was into something totally different realm. Luke 18:29. And he said unto them, verily I say unto you, there is no man that has left his house or parents or brethren, wife or children for the kingdom of God's sake, who shall not receive manifold more at this present time and in the world to come. He's actually quoting Matthew 6, right? The last verse. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and I will add all these things. And I can tell you, I stand here as a witness, a person who had everything in the corporate world and who said, Lord, I want that narrow door. I want to find you through that narrow gate. And my wife will bear witness that we have never, ever looked back. Our table has been blessed praise the Lord. We have been clothed, praise the Lord. We have traveled in absolute comfort, praise the Lord. He is true to His word. The only thing is, have you left your house? Have you left your job? Have you left what man was promising you and said, Lord, here I come empty-handed, because what you're going to give me is more than what man can. That's the difference. The problem is, when most Christians come up for prayer, they're carrying their old suitcases with them. Throw your old suitcases and come to the Lord. He'll give you a brand new one. He says, give me your yoke and take mine, for mine is light. No, Lord, I like this old suitcase. I like all my old problems. I'm coming to you with my mother-in-law, with my father-in-law, with the dog that follows me. You know, you can't do that. You can't do that. If you come to Him, you must come unconditionally. Acts 2:21, and it shall come to pass that whoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. This is what Peter is quoting to the temple priest. He's quoting this to Peter. Peter is quoting this to the temple guards. This is nothing to do with the church. And people are saying this is the church. No. He's quoting an Old Testament prophet and saying, listen, this is the time period where this prophecy is now beginning to be fulfilled about the kingdom. That if you call upon God, He'll save you. He'll sozo. Acts 2:47, praising God and having favor with all people, and the Lord added to the church daily as should be saved. So can you see, the prophecy of Joel now is starting to manifest. Why? The Holy Spirit has come down. You understand? And people are being saved. They are coming into salvation. The message finally, the coin has dropped. Acts 4:12, neither is there Yeshua, salvation, in any other. Now this is being quoted by Peter to the entire Sanhedrin. Neither is there salvation in any. In short, he's saying, it's not your rituals of burnt offerings. It's not what the pagans do, cutting themselves in front of Baalim and Ashtoreth, or offering their children in the fire. He's saying, if you want sozo, it's in Yeshua. For there is none other name under heaven given among men where we must be saved. He's saying this is unconditional. This is the condition. If you accept, if you want to be saved in eternity, you have to accept Yeshua. Am I going too slow or am I going too fast? Is this okay? Because you know, this is a lot of scripture, but you have to understand, this is what you have to get into. Acts chapter 11 verse 14. Who shall tell thee words whereby thou and thy house shall be saved? Acts 15:1, and certain men which came down from Judea taught the brethren and said, except ye be circumcised after the manner of Moses, you cannot be saved. Yeah, this is the problem. Guess who was saying this? The brother of Jesus, whom we call James, because they were traditional Jews. And we are saying this is the church. This is nonsense. And Acts chapter 15 is a crucial chapter, because that is the Jerusalem Council. That is where Rav Shaul, after 10 years of being saved, he comes and lets the apostles have it. He says, you are hypocrites. He says, this is not why God came and saved us. He came and saved us that we as Jews can take the message of sozo to the world. He says, to accept Christ, you do not have to keep Shabbat. You don't have to obey the Torah. You do not have to be circumcised. He says, charis is a free gift from God to those who believe. You understand? They were saying, no, if you are not in the synagogue on Shabbat, if you are not circumcised, if you are not doing wearing a talit, you can't get saved. No. I wear this because I love wearing it. I love wearing it. I believe I am honoring God by wearing this. But this has nothing to do with my salvation. Salvation is a free gift from God. You understand? Don't get religious. Acts Acts 16:30. And they brought them out and said, "Sirs, what must we do to be saved?" This is Paul and Silas. What do we have to do to be saved? And he says, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ." 1 Corinthians 18. "For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but to us which are being saved, it's the power of God." I think I missed a slide here. Yeah. Please understand, if you study the Bible the way I study it, you will find 57 references of the word sozo. 57 words, 57 passages of the word sozo. So you'll get very mixed up, very complexed, complicated. We're going to learn now what sozo is all about. What must I do to be saved? Salvation is something people try to study as a subject. You can't do that. You have to walk in faith, and that's what Paul is talking to the church in Corinth. Romans 5:9. "Much more then, being justified by his blood, we shall be saved from the wrath through him." Because of the blood, the wrath of God will not hit us. The wrath of God is not for us. It's for those who reject him. "If a man's work shall be burned, he shall suffer loss, but he himself shall be saved, yet so as by fire." Ephesians 2:5. How has God quickened us? He has quickened us the moment we said, "Father, come into our lives. Come into our lives." That's how he quickened us. And then what has happened? He says, "By grace ye are saved through your faith." Through your faith, and not of yourselves, it is a gift. So sozo is a gift from God. If somebody gives you a gift, you can't give him a bill after that, can you? Now if I gift you something and you say thank you very much, and 2 seconds later I give you a bill and say, would it be cash or check or credit card? Then it's not a gift. But here he's saying it's a gift. Once I give it to you, I'm not going to take it back. There's no price for a gift. So, now comes to the crucial point. There in scripture, there are three types of sozo. Three types. The first is, there is being saved. That's the first category. The second category is, will be saved. And the third category is, are saved. Are these three groups of people? No. It's the same individual. One part of you, right, is being saved. One part will be saved. One part are saved. Why is that? Because we are first spirit, we are then body, we are then mind. We are first spirit, we are then body, and eventually we are mind. Soul, mind, and body. The soul and the mind is being saved. The soul and the mind is being saved. The spirit has been saved. The body will be saved. Let me go through that again. Mom, maybe you can explain that to Tushari. The soul and the mind is being saved. It's a process. The mind is being changed the way we think. The body will be saved when we get a new body. But the spirit has been saved. Once the spirit has been saved, you can't lose your salvation. There are some churches that say once you're saved, you can lose your salvation. They make God a liar. Once the Holy Spirit has been given to you, God, you see, we can't pray David's prayer. Don't take my, you know, after he slept with Bathsheba, he says, "Lord, don't take your spirit away from me." We can't pray that prayer because we are saved by grace, not by works. Okay? Now let's look at the scripture. There is a threefold salvation process. Romans 5:10. For if we were, when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of His Son. How were we reconciled? What is reconciled means? Brought into balance, no? Everything being made equal. Much more being reconciled, we shall be saved by His life body. So here it's talking about the body. Saved by His life, how? Our body will be saved. We will get a transfigured body, and that's what 2 Corinthians 5, 1 and 2 talks about, the oikotherion, that we are waiting for this celestial body, a new body. Not this body that we are pumping with Botox and all the tox. You understand? We are going to get a celestial body, the same body that Yeshua has, right? We shall be saved by His life. Let's talk about the body. 1 Corinthians 1:18. For the preaching of the cross to them that perish is foolishness, but unto us which are being saved. Right? That is the soul. Are being saved. So the soul is being saved. It's being changed. Right? I would love to marry 5 women. The Holy Spirit says, no. You will marry only 1 woman. Husbands, love your wives. You understand? So that's that battle. So the soul is being saved. Right? It's a process. Right? And then Romans 8:24. For we are saved by hope. By the hope that is not hope. For what a man seeth, why doth he yet hope for? It's the spirit. Ephesians 2:5. When we were dead in our sins, He has quickened us together with Christ. By grace ye are saved. So the Spirit is already a done deal. When you stand in front of God and you say, Lord, I'm a sinner. Transform me, Lord. Save me. I'm making a covenant with you, Lord, that your blood, when it's applied to my sins, it's sealed. The blood of Christ seals that promise when you accept Him. Are we good here? Can I move? Did you understand that? It's very important. 7 points to ponder. First is that salvation, sozo, is a gift from God. Romans 11:6. And if by grace, then it's no more works. It's either grace or it's works. And this is where the Roman Catholics are in an absolute mess. Because they say that they are saved, but if they don't go to church, if they don't go and visit Mary in Lourdes, and Madhu and Ladu and Badu and all this muck, you know. I mean, yesterday we were in a departmental store and I met my cousin. And she said, you know, I had to go to Madhu, but because of my sickness, I couldn't go. And Mary is going to get angry. She's going to go on Facebook and say, this woman didn't come to see me in Madhu. This is an abomination to God. It is by grace ye are saved, not by works. Otherwise, grace is no more grace. As I said, if I give you a gift and ask you, would it be cash or check? It's not a gift. A gift is a free gift. Am I correct? And it's nice to get a gift, isn't it? There's a big difference in parcel post where you have to pay for the gift. But when you get something free, it's like, wow, why me, Lord? Because I love you. Simple. It's a gift. Right? If it is by grace, then it is no more of works. Otherwise, grace is no more grace. But if it is of works, then it is no more grace. Otherwise, the work is no more work. Now, how does this work? How does this grace work? You have a bank account. Just because you have a bank account, it's not a good thing. Because some people have bank accounts which are in the minus. There are some figures there. But that tells you you owe the bank. That's not a bank account. That's a dead account. Right? There's no point saying I have a bank account of 1 million. And then you say, but I owe the bank that 1 million. That's a red letter bank account. It has strobe lights. It's flashing all the time saying, you owe me, you owe me. Right? And then what happens is, you accept Christ and suddenly that red letter is taken and put into Jesus' account where He says, totelestai, paid in full. And He takes His account and transfers it to your account, and suddenly you see numbers coming in the black, nice numbers, which you can now go out and spend. That's grace. That's grace. It's a bank transfer. His grace into your account, which was in deficit. You were in deficit. You were at enmity with God. Now he puts his money into your account. Now you say, wow, now I can go and live. That's grace. Amen. It's eternal life. The second thing about sozo is it is eternal life. Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin is death. Now, what does it mean by sin? It's very simple. Getting into a bus and going to Madhu to worship Mary is a sin. It's an absolute sin. It's a rejection of God's grace. And I'm telling you, tomorrow and today, there are thousands of people heading to Madhu. And they are loving it. And God is hating it. He does not want you to go anywhere. He wants you to be stark naked in the shower singing, Hallelujah. He loves it. Really? He appreciates you rubbing soap on your body and saying, Father, I praise you. Yeah, why not? Instead of being in a bus with everybody's sweat on you to see some woman who was dead. Come on, get real. Don't insult God. It's eternal life. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. It is Him, and it is Him, and it is Him. Period. John 2:25, and this is the promise that He has promised us, even eternal life. Please understand this. You don't have to do anything except stand in front of Him and say, you don't have to stand, you can kneel, you can sit, you can sleep, you can still receive salvation. Lord, save me, Lord. Lord, save me. That's all. Receive the Son and you will have everlasting life. Are we learning something here today? Is it changing the way you're thinking? Yeah? Praise God. John 5:13. These things I have written unto you, that you believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that ye have eternal life, and that ye may believe on the name of the Son of God. That's your eternal life. That's your credit card to eternity. Just believing Jesus is my Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Number three, it is total forgiveness. It is not partial forgiveness. You don't have to starve. You don't have to go on a diet. You don't have to do fasting and prayer. You don't have to kneel. You don't have to light candles. You don't have to ride coconut oil. You don't have to do any of those things. You don't have to go on pilgrimage. You have to just receive the free gift. Acts 13:38. Be it known unto you, therefore, men and brethren, that through this man is preached unto you the forgiveness of sins. You could have been a whore in this life, and you could be in heaven. You could have been the perfect virgin. Sad life. Yeah, you know, I mean, I've met a lot of virgins in my life, and they're the most frustrated old women, you know, because they have thought, you know, we can't deal with these men, we are so good. Yeah, they're like a battery that never left the shelf. That's there on the shelf. Never was used. You understand? The Word of God said it is not good for man to be alone. Right? Okay. I'm telling you, there are a lot of nice people in hell. There are some very nice people who fed the dogs on the road. Right? That's why there's that song, Don't Let the Dogs Out. Right? Okay. There are some people who are very good at feeding pigeons, cats. There are some. I walked into a house one day. This lady wanted me to help her to rent her. She came for a prayer meeting and said, can you help me to get some tenants into my house? And I walked into that place and I was like, I can't breathe. It smelt of cat poo. It smelt of cat urine. There were cats all over the place. And she wants to know why somebody won't rent that place. Not even Satan will go inside there. It smelled. She smelled the cat smell. The place smelled. Yes. So she had come for a prayer meeting for all the wrong reasons. You understand? This is nonsense. please understand that when God gives you something, He said, Totelestai, paid in full. It is finished. You don't have to do nothing. You don't have to go into the garden and plant flowers for Him. You just have to go and tell people, I am transformed. I have got eternal life because of Jesus Christ. There's only one thing you can do. And they overcame him, who, Satan, by the blood of the Lamb and the testimony of men. That's all. That's all. If you tell people that Jesus did this for you, somewhere in their psyche, the coin will drop one day. And they'll call you back after 5 years and say, that Jesus that saved you, is he still around? He's the same yesterday, today and forever. Just because you witness to somebody today doesn't mean that the coin is going to drop. Sometimes it takes a little bit longer. But you tell them, my life has been changed by Yeshua HaMashiach, the Lord God Himself. Amen. Jeremiah 31:34, and they shall teach no more every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, know the Lord, for they shall know me, from the least of them unto the greatest of them, said the Lord, for I will forgive their iniquity, I will remember it no more. Now he's saying this to Israel. He's saying this to Israel, who are burning, killing and burning bullocks and lambs and pigeons as blood sacrifices. How much more the blood of Christ? How much more the blood of Christ? Because Hebrews says, and he made a once and for all sacrifice and entered the Holy of Holies. Hallelujah. Entered once and for all. Psalm 103:12. For as the east is from the west, so far he has removed our transgressions from us. If you can measure how far it goes beyond Taiwan and Hawaii and all the east, and go on the other side, right, past the Pacific, if you can measure that, tell yourself that's how far he went to wipe out our sins. As far from the east is from the west, he has removed transgressions from us. Hallelujah. Doesn't that make you feel good? He has done it all. Amen. Number four, justification, the root of justice. The word justification comes from the root word justice. Romans 3:24, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ. He has made us right. He has made us equal unto God through Jesus Christ. I know this is very heavy, but this scripture, once it gets into your head, believe you me, you will be a free person. Romans 3:25, whom God had sent forth to be a propitiation. Propitiation means the ideal thing, what God will accept as a sacrifice, through faith in his blood, to declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past through the forbearance of God. What an amazing statement, through the forbearance of God. Galatians 2:16, knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but by the faith of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ. Even have we believed in Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, that we might be justified by faith. And this is this Greek word pistis. Whenever you see the word faith, remember the Greek word pistis. Pistis means that we have accepted him unconditionally. Unconditionally. And not by works of the law, for by works of the law shall no flesh be justified. You cannot do any works and be justified. Number five, righteousness. Romans 4:3. For what said the scripture? Abraham believed God and it was counted unto him for righteousness. It was counted. God changed the account numbers. He transferred from his account into Abraham's account and said, now he's righteous. Does God send people to hell? No, he doesn't. Anybody who goes to hell goes by rejecting the grace of God. God doesn't send anybody to hell. It is your rejection of his grace. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believe in him should not perish but have everlasting life. It means we were all going to hell and he pulled us out. That's what it meant. Everybody is born going to hell. There are no good people born. All fall short of the glory of God. Romans 3:23. All fall short of the glory of God. So the difference is, every person who is born is on their way to hell. It is by grace and faith, pistis, charis and pistis, that we are pulled out. Number 6. Redemption. Redeemed. 1 Corinthians 6:19. What? Knowing not that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, which is in you, which ye have of God, and not ye are not on your own. For ye are bought with a price. What is the price? The blood of Christ. Therefore, I glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. Matthew 7:21 to Luke 6:46. And why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say? Every tree that bringeth not forth good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire. He's saying, if you don't listen to what I'm saying, you will not bear fruit. And if you don't bear fruit, you will go up into the fire, you will go to hell. Therefore, by their fruits you shall know them. There are many people who claim to be Christians, but their fruit will tell you whether they are Christians or not, born of the Spirit or not. Not everyone that saith to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he that doth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Please understand that. It is appointed by God unto men. But you can only do that through your faith factor. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name? Have we not cast out devils in thy name? Many wonderful works. And he will say, and then I will profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that worketh iniquity. So a lot of people are going to get into a shock system when they meet the Lord. But I thought all who believe are saved. Isn't that what the scripture said? If you believe. James says, thou believest that there is one God. Great. Awesome. That's a great thing. You've got a brain and you believe that there is a God. But does thou will? So do the devils in hell, and they tremble. So just believing that there is God doesn't make you a Christian. Even the devils believe that there is God. But they are going to hell. They are in hell. And there are many people who believe there is God. Right? There are many people in this country who believe, even in our region it talks about hell. Yeah, man, who has the keys? Read Revelation chapter 1. Jesus says, I, Yeshua HaMashiach, I hold the keys of death and Hades. I. Nobody else. Right? So just believing that there is God doesn't make you a Christian. Submitting to the total will. That is the main thing about God. He must be Lord of all or not at all. Either he is Lord of everything in your life or not at all. You can't say, you know, this is my little bit. This is mine from the past. My blast from the past. No. Either he is Lord of all or not at all. Either you are totally submitted to your life or you have not. That's the problem with Christians. They're not totally submitted. So they're struggling. You have either died to him or you're dying to this world. Some people say, no, I am dying to get that watch. I am dying to buy that dress. I am dying to go to that place in holiday. You're dying to the world. You think some watch on your wrist is going to make you Superman. You won't even end up as Spider-Man. Leave alone Superman. The watch. People are going to look at the watch and think, oh, what a great guy this guy is. Oh, the car. Nonsense. Nonsense. He'll give you more than that. Receive him. If you have submitted to his will, then he will seal you. He will cleanse you with his blood. Please understand that. Submission is the small gate that you enter. You are submitting, you're bending down and saying, Lord, I need to come through this gate. It's submitting. What is submitting? Saying, listen, I agree with you. That's what submitting is, no? You are here listening to me because you have submitted to yourselves that if you walk in here, you learn about God. You are submitting. That's all it means. I am willing to accept what you say. That's a submission. That's all it is. Ephesians 1:19, having made known unto us the mystery of his will. His will is a mystery to us, according to his good pleasure, which he has purposed himself, that in the dispensation, now here's that word, disapendre in Latin and oikonomia in Greek, of the fullness of times, he might gather together all, one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven, which are on earth, and even in him, in whom we have obtained an inheritance. First thing he does is, he gives us an inheritance of eternity. He says, what is in heaven belongs to you. That's the first thing you receive with salvation. Being predestined according to the purpose of him who worketh all things after the counsel of his own will. Whom does he take counsel? Himself. He takes counsel in himself and he says, if these people receive me, they will get my inheritance. It's as simple as that. That we should be the praise of his glory who first trusted in Christ. That's a faith situation. You trusted in Christ. Now comes the winner. In whom ye also trusted, after ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also that you believed, you were sealed with the Spirit of promise. You were sealed. Once you are sealed, you are vacuum packed. Have you ever seen anything that's vacuum packed? You can't break through to it, can you? If you get a spare part or anything that's vacuum packed, it's sealed. If you throw water at it, the water bounces off it. Whatever Satan throws at you is going to bounce off, because God has sealed you with the promise of the Holy Spirit. And that seal is written onto your spirit. So what is being saved right now is your mind. It's being saved from the world. What will be saved is your body. But what has been sealed already is the spirit that's going before God. Amen? What do we have to conclude with? That once you stand for the first time before a pastor or a fellow Christian and say, I want to receive Christ as my personal Savior. Do you know, in the twinkling of an eye, now a twinkling of an eye, they say, right, is faster, right, than anything else that they've seen. Light can go around the world 7.5 times. Light. 7.5 times. That's the speed. It can go around the world 7.5 times. And it says that the twinkling of an eye is faster than that. When you receive Christ into your life, the first thing you do is you get an eternal inheritance. You get your sins wiped away. He does not remember your sins as far as the east is from the west. You get a glorified body at the resurrection. You become a child of God. And more than anything else, he says, while you're on this earth, I'm going to bless your house. You will have food in your house. You will not be naked. He says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and I will add. And what you have to consider today is, if you are struggling, there's only one thing that I can tell you as a pastor. You have not submitted to God. Either he's Lord of all or not at all. And that's a point you need to ask God about. I can't tell you. If you have not submitted your will to God, you are at the gate. You have not walked through the gate. I walked through that gate. I know what it's like. It's a very narrow gate. Very few find it. But once you come through that gate, you can't even measure the field. It's a field of glory. It's a field of blessing. It's a field where you don't have to look back. You will never look back, because you will never find that gate again. Once you're through that gate, it's eternal life. Now, this is not prosperity gospel. This is a fact. This is a fact because I'm living it. I do not look back, but I look to my redemption, which is coming nigh. Amen. Shall we pray? Hallelujah. Father, I just want to thank you. I want to praise you, Lord, for everything, Lord, that you have taught us today. Lord, I know that we are saved by grace. It is a free will of God. It's a free will gift from God. Father, I just thank you for the blood. I thank you, Lord, that we are sealed with the promise of the Holy Spirit. Lord, I just pray that our minds be renewed. that we come to worship you from our mind to our spirit to our bodies, because our bodies are the temple of the Holy Spirit. Father, I know that I will get a new body. I know that my mind is transformed to worshiping you, and I know my spirit is sealed, and I want to praise you, I want to thank you, and I want to bless your holy name. And everybody said, Amen. Father, this is how you told Aaron to bless the people. Ivarekaka Adonai Vishmareka. Ye Adonai Paniveleka Vihunuleka. Isa Adonai Paniveleka Vyashemleka Shalom. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you, and may he give you his shalom shalom, his peace. In Yeshua HaMashiach's name, Amen.